Hey! Good to see you, man.
That was a very manly microphone clunk.
We have to do it that way.
Yeah, it has to happen. How's everybody doing?
Fantastic.
Super. I'm going to resist singing that old song, Starting Over. But that really is a wonderful way to think about this conversation. And it's something that you've believed in for, I guess, a long, long time.
Yeah.
And I'm curious, throwing away the fabulous set of questions that I prepared, at what point in your life did you start asking yourself that question, what would it be like in blank if we just decided to start over? When did that type of anarchy, when it comes to remaking our world, become a dominant mover for you personally?
I love when the word anarchy is used in a positive way too,
because that's what it
felt like to me. I don't know if I've ever even shared this story with you. I was in law school about 7 years ago. I didn't know what the hell I didn't want to do with my life, so I went to law school, and I was walking in the law school quad with a friend of mine, this young woman named Aviva Marathi, and my heart skipped a beat. I had a heart palpitation, and she said, "What's wrong?" And I said, "Just feel a little bit weird. My heart kind of skipped." And she said, "Well, you know, my dad's a cardiologist." And he actually specializes in something called electrophysiology, which is the exact kind of discipline that would warrant seeing someone like me.
Uh-huh.
So she convinced me to go see the doctor, Dr. Fred Marathi. I went in. At the time, I was a big athlete. And he said, "Josh, I got bad news. You have something called hypertrophic cardiomyopathy."
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know what that meant. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is actually the leading cause of death among young athletes under the age of 35. If you remember an old basketball player.
And you were
playing
football, right?
I was playing football. There's an old basketball player named Hank Gathers who unfortunately died because of it.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, "You're lucky you didn't die." And he said, "You got to stop playing sports. Got to stop lifting weights intensely." So my life, my identity, you know, Andrew as an athlete, was just shattered. But it did something really special to me. It gave me sort of an understanding that life is really short. And I asked myself, like, what would it look like if I just start over in my own life? What would it look like if I didn't have a bullshit soul-sucking job at a law firm like all my other friends? Like, what would it look like if I actually committed my life to something different? And that was the first time.
It's amazing because I have a personal theory, and I have shared this with you. It's, you know, 25 years ago, I sat in a hotel room just wanting to die.
Yeah.
And I was a drug addict and alcoholic, and I didn't. I lived, I got sober, stayed sober, and the idea of starting over was actually something that we've both had to put into practice and completely remake what we were doing.
Yeah.
And that's my advice to lots of people is always just think about starting over, which I think is why when you and I met each other, we sort of clicked. We've over the years spent a lot of time talking about remaking, rethinking, rebuilding systems around the world, energy, water, politics. And you started with food.
Yeah.
And that was a very personal decision for you. Why?
Yeah. The biggest reason is maybe like a lot of you, I didn't grow up with a lot of money. Grew up in Birmingham, Alabama. My mom pretty much just fed me via food stamps. And she fed me a lot of shitty food. Like, we grew up on a lot of shitty food. And my family has a history of heart disease, history of type 2 diabetes. And I would ask her, like, "What's going on, Mom? You know, why are we eating like this?" It wasn't like I was some, you know, conscious eater back when I was 10, but I was at least aware that we weren't eating that good. And she would always say we didn't have a lot of money. And that was the reason. So after I decided not to pursue a soul-sucking job at a law firm, I thought, man, what would it look like if I threw my life into something meaningful? And when you look at all these big systems, when you look at energy, when you look at healthcare, when you look at campaign finance, when you look at food, and you ask yourself, what would it look like if we just started these damn things from scratch? Food is one that for me became the most compelling, both because of my my history with my family, but also because it's so screwed up, Andrew. I mean, it is this system that's just built these habits, these preconceptions, this crap that we've loaded on our food system, if we just look at it a little bit different, there's so much good that we can do.
The we've built a house on stilts.
Yeah, we have.
With the food system in our country. And I believe we're in the middle of a 25-year social change movement, similar to the one that we dealt with cigarettes.
Yeah.
Similar to the one that we dealt with you know, getting people to use seatbelts in their cars.
Yeah.
Where the prospects of continuing down the road are so completely untenable that the only choice is to change.
Yeah.
But change for human beings is extremely, extremely difficult.
Yeah.
And when you decided to do create Hampton Creek, you put together an incredible group of engineers and scientists and botanists and, you know, words I can't describe. I can't pronounce, so I'm not going to embarrass myself.
I still can barely pronounce them.
But I remember the first day we met at the old headquarters in San Francisco, and what struck me as being the most fascinating thing, and I know this is going to sound weird, but there are Fortune 30 food companies out there that will talk to you for 2 or 3 hours and never bring up the word food. They'll talk about brands, but they won't talk about food, and they will never use the word chef.
Yeah.
There's such a distance between the notion that they are a huge food company, but yet they're not really in the business of making food. They think they're in the business of doing something else.
Yeah.
You had, you know, I mean, there are probably 70 people in the room, but you wanted me, and I mean, obviously, I'm a chef, so fit, but you had chefs there and treated them as equally important, if not more important, than any of the other people who were supplying them with you. You created a food company at the heart and soul of which is a maker,
That's it.
And that's really different. And so I'm fascinated as to how that started, and now, so many years later, because you didn't even really have a product when you and I met.
No.
And now, you're one of the fastest growing food companies in the world.
Yeah.
So, I mean, chefs are even more at the forefront. Talk to me about that relationship.
Well, you know, it goes a little bit back to what would it look like we start over. So when I started Hampton Creek, I didn't know anything about food either. I mean, I knew I was raised on a lot of crappy food, but beyond that, I didn't know a lot about food. So when I started and I started imagining creating a company that was hopefully gonna make food that's better for the body and better for the world, taste better and be more affordable. And that's kind of the premise of Hampton Creek. If you make it like that, even if people don't give a damn about eating well, they'll still eat well, right? I would ask a lot of people who had experience in the food industry, well, who are the people we should hire? And they said, well, you gotta hire some food scientists, right? You gotta hire food scientists. And I said, well, what about chefs? And they said, well, if you wanna do kind of show things, right? If you wanna put on events, you should get the chefs. If you wanna have you know, tutorials for people, maybe if you want to have a special little kitchen,
see,
you bring
in chefs. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. I mean, it's just crazy, right?
It is crazy. It is crazy. And so we hired a couple of food scientists. They didn't work out. I let them go. And I watched a TED Talk, actually. These two chefs work at a restaurant called Modo, which unfortunately closed down recently in Chicago. But it specializes in kind of a science-driven culinary approach. And through that, I found a guy named Chris Jones, who at the time was the director of cuisine at Modo, and I invited him to come. And man, Chris got there, and unlike some of the food scientists that we were working with, he just wanted to go. He wanted to just create. He didn't want to even talk to me, right? He just like got in there and just got his hands in it. And then we realized along the way that we cannot create a food company that's different without having chefs actually at the lead. So when I respect my computational biologists and these fancy names a whole bunch, but chefs drive what we do. They're in the lead of creating things. If they don't just give at the end and have the stamp of approval. They're a part of the entire process, and it's really been cool for me to see how that's taken hold in our company.
I mean, obviously, it's easier now today to get some of the best and the brightest.
Yeah.
But you essentially went out, I mean, Modo under Homaro Kantu, who was a friend of mine for 20 years.
Yeah, so.
He committed suicide last year. So it's very sad story. But I spent a lot of time in that kitchen and had met Chris and had met Richie.
Yeah.
You know, these guys, the couple of times I had stuck my head in there. And, you know, Moto was not an inexpensive restaurant. So you took the amazing chefs, and you've kept building an incredible stable of culinarians who were used to feeding the 1%, and you've repurposed them to be cooking for, or creating, making.
Yep.
I'm gonna keep using the word maker because I have a point about this whole thing at some point. For the 99%.
Yeah.
Was that conscious, unconscious, part of the general soul of how you wanted to start?
Yeah, I
Hampton
mean, it,
Creek.
It, yeah, it's Andrew. It's part of. I think we realized when Chris came in. I didn't know if that it was a theory, right? I know what the hell I was doing. I was just experimenting.
Right.
With food scientists didn't work just alone, so let's try a chef.
You don't really know what you're doing right now either, but it just keeps working.
That's right.
That may be your secret.
You just keep experimenting with it. You see what's going on. But I think what's been interesting is, you know, chefs, you know, and you know as one, the culture of restaurants can be a little bit overwhelming sometimes, right? I mean, these are some of the most talented people in the entire world, right? And often they're not getting paid the best, right? The hours are insane. And they realize, wait a second, I'm only making food for a small number of people, right? And when Chris came in, you began to see Chris's eyes open up to this, like, wait a second. What I make is actually going out to millions of mouths. And he got inspired by it. And then Chris ended up recruiting other chefs. And then I realized a big competitive advantage that we have is the respect that we show chefs. Like, we revere them.
Mm-hmm.
And to pull them away from some of the top restaurants in the world and say, listen, here's a platform that you can be, you can still be yourself. You can still be a chef, but you can just do it in a way that is impacting people at a scale that you hadn't even imagined before. And it's been something that we got a little bit a taste of, and we just keep going after it.
It's smart too. Eating well in America, eating well in the world is a class issue.
Yeah.
I mean, that's sad.
It is.
And, you know, just like, you know, education and other systems that we talk about, so much of it now has become a class issue that to reorient the smart people, the talented people towards working, solving bigger problems for more people. Chefs have huge egos and no self-esteem, at least the ones I know. And so, but at their very heart, they want to change. They want to give people the hug that food gives them.
Yep.
Now you see that hug in magazines and stuff, and we all open up the pages and there's, you know, some gorgeous table on the cliffs of Malibu in a house that none of us can afford with food that, I mean, just to me, it's selling, you know, the ruby red slippers that don't exist, as opposed to selling real food solutions to people. I know that's one of the reasons why I wanted to get out of kitchens. I felt like I was wandering aimlessly in the desert. I was having huge success, but at the very core of it, my biggest problem was that I wasn't reaching enough people.
Yeah.
And I thought, if I wanted, I need to start over.
Yeah.
I need to get into television. Television to me at the time, there were no iPhones when I started doing TV. There wasn't a lot of other ways to do it. I needed to get on television and start talking about cultures and other things. So you talk, my point being is that expanding platforms allows us to affect and reach more people. And so you've used this idea of starting over with yourself, then with these chefs, with the botanists and biologists and the business people and
computational
PRs
biologists
and marketers.
Too.
Yeah, exactly, the whole nine yards. And you've motivated them. And you've sort of used that rallying cry to galvanize investors, customers, everyone. So I'm wondering, now that this has been going on for a couple of years, and you have more products, how do you see the landscape of food changing, more than just when you put out just mayo?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, there's so many products out there. You're using food to change so many different systems.
Yeah.
Because the minute you grow the food, that the numbers of foods that you're making, and you've just launched a lot of products and announced even more, you start to affect and change things radically.
Yeah. I remember you telling me, Andrew, one time about what you do, and you told me that for you, food is a story. Mm-hmm. And food is, you said to me, people think sometimes my show is about food.
Yes.
But it's actually not.
It could be about widgets.
Right. It's exactly about, you know, it's about communities, it's about story, it's about identity. And I remember that, and I think with each passing day at Hampton Creek, I see that more and more. It's a story about justice too. Mm-hmm. You know, you mentioned that this justice issue and this inequity in food, and it's something that's always pissed us off, because when you think about food as a system, most food out there is crappy food, right? Most food out there is shitty for the body, shitty for the planet. We eat it because it tastes really good and it's affordable, it's available everywhere. But the good food, right, the food that's a little bit better, is way too expensive, doesn't work for friends that I grew up with in Alabama, right? Might work for people, you know, here in Austin or where I live in San Francisco.
Well, it works for everyone if you're educated on how to utilize it, but handing someone a bunch of ingredients and then showing them a picture in a magazine and saying, get from here to there.
It doesn't work.
It doesn't work.
It doesn't work. So I think what we've tried to do all along is, you know, remember that we have to remember why we started. No matter how many products we have, no matter how much money we're fortunate enough to raise, no matter what, we have to remember that our answer to starting over is food that is better for the body and better for the planet, always being affordable. And it doesn't matter if we launch a million products, that needs to be our moral compass. And we've been really lucky that even though we've raised all this capital, that we have control over this. We have the ability to shape this in the way that we want. And that's exciting. And it's exciting for impact, not just in sodium taken out of the system, but last year we saved over 2 billion gallons of water. In the future, we're really excited about bringing in more farmers, not just in the U.S., but around the world, into a better food economy.
The better food economy, it was actually something I was going to talk to you about later on, but when we met, and, you know, we shared some stuff privately, and to me, food is about stories.
Yep.
And it's about stories that unite us. It's about, you know, I don't want to talk about things that divide us. I don't want to talk about I have different skin color, speak a different language, or a different sexuality, or a different religion than that person over there. We both love food. We like sharing it with other people.
Yeah.
We believe that there is a transformative ability that food and travel, I believe, has for culture. We learn about things and then can import them back into our lives and become better people by experiencing food in other places with other people. I'm convinced of it. I've seen it work. I've also been around the world 17 times and been to 167 countries, mm-hmm. and we find it's less expensive to make TV in warm climates. There's a dirty little secret, which is why I'm always tan. We learned in the first season, going to Alaska in winter is really bad for $200,000 TV cameras, so we stopped doing that. And I've been around the equatorial belt, and I've been in countries where people are starving because of distribution, but they're able to grow anything all year round. I mean, stuff just keeps growing like crazy and faster and better than other stuff. And when we first started talking about what was in the protein mixture for the mayo,
yep.
the quote-unquote egg, I don't want to use a substitute, but what was going to be the replace the egg
yep.
in the mayonnaise, you whispered in my ear a couple of the plants that you had analyzed and found had these properties, because an egg has 22, 24 different properties in cooking. You had to learn what plants yep. were going to replace them all. And I looked at you and I said, the implications for solving poverty issues in fourth world nations around the equatorial belt for you know, I spent 10 years trying to figure out a way to decentralize the food system in America through farmers and not have 75% of our production come through, you know, a handful of giant sized companies.
Yeah.
And I taste, and by tasting just mayo, I looked at you and I said, this is a job. This isn't a food product. This is a jobs bill for the world.
Yeah.
This is an economic development program for places. Tell me about how that's been over the last couple years as you've ramped up production of this stuff.
Well, you know, we've gone you didn't see our 300 square foot studio apartment yet. You saw the one after that, but we went from a 300 square foot studio apartment to about a 4,000 square foot place to now a 95,000 square foot place with 125 people. But I think the thing I am really excited about is we as a world have forgotten the bountiful nature of crops all out there, right? We got addicted to soy and corn, right? I mean, your show does a good job. You're showing people everything that's out there. We've forgotten about it because of habit, because of addiction, subsidies a little bit.
Yeah.
But we got 400,000 species of plants out there. 92% of them haven't really been explored for how they can make food better. And a lot of these are growing in some of these third and fourth world places.
And by the way, ones that we do know about that are fucking delicious.
Yeah, totally.
Sweet potato vines and sweet potato leaves and all these things that, like, it's crazy.
I'll give you a good example. So we have pancakes and muffins and all things like that are about to launch with a lot of the big retailers out there. And we use a grain called sorghum. Sorghum is grown in the Midwest. It's also grown in West Africa. And I used to live in a little country in West Africa called Liberia, mm-hmm. Third poorest country on the planet. We just went there, talked to a few farmers there, and we really see a world in which whether sorghum, whether all sorts of varietals of beans, even cassava in West Africa, that you can create markets for these crops. Markets that end up impacting a single mom that's shopping at a Walmart in Birmingham, Alabama, too, right? And I think that's the ultimate vision of Hampton Creek. How do we, and hopefully other companies that follow, too, right? How do we make it easy for a single mom in Alabama living on food stamps to eat well? And in so doing, bring these farmers, not just in the Midwest, but around the world, into that. And it's something that I think is intriguing to the conservative amongst us and the liberal amongst us, right? Because everyone agrees, whether you're a Trump protester or a Trump supporter, right? Everyone agrees that food that's a little bit better for you should be affordable and taste well, right? No one disagrees with that. No one has to protest that or debate that. And the question is, how the hell do we do that?
Right. The other thing that no one would disagree with is that if we put people to work, if instead of a city, statewide, or national jobs program that creates economic development in the places that need it most, if we as real leaders, if we were going to start over with that kind of thinking, since the planet has shrunk, shouldn't we have a global jobs bill, a global economic development approach? And why shouldn't a entrepreneur in the food space, like you, lead that charge? Because jobs in Liberia mean families being able to afford health care and education, whatever it looks like in that country.
Yep.
And maybe it prevents, in some countries, disaffected youth going off and saying, screw it, and getting involved in drugs or crime or terrorism or violence against their siblings or spouse. I mean, you think about the problems that can be solved by just giving people the sprinkle of dignity and respect that a job gives is actually what first attracted me to Hampton Creek. I mean, the food product was great, but that bigger idea of what it would look like in this supply chain, that part of starting over was shocking. You used a word before, you used the word subsidy, and I don't want to have a conversation about subsidizing corn and soy, which is just a whole other awful thing we could spend hours talking about. But one of the things that there's a couple of men of a certain age who are kind of, we're getting together to sort of stop talking about food problems in this world and start talking only about how we can legislate food change in this world. And we have a big announcement coming soon, a group of us. You're getting more active in Washington, D.C. too. That's
a
big bear to take on.
But
if we don't, personally, if we don't make things laws, they won't work. Yep. The reason that nobody has asked any candidate what they think about school lunch programs and what side they stand or what they think about, I mean, there is no national food policy, right? We do not have a national food policy that is in lockstep with what we all collectively would come up if we all worked at a couple blackboards and whiteboards for a couple weeks. Doesn't exist. But we could come up, the people in this room could come up with a pretty darn good one. No one has asked any of the candidates that because from a legislative standpoint, nothing like that exists already, so they have nothing to speak to. So you got to create that legislative piece of business for politicians to respond to.
You do. Yeah, I mean, it drives me crazy. I mean, watching these debates, both on the Democrat and Republican side, never, I don't know if there's been a question about food in the last 30 years in a debate, in fact. You know, I mean, think about that.
The last time was during the Reagan years, and it came up as a joke because the laws were changed, took equipment out of schools, and tomato became a vegetable.
I mean,
a serviceable vegetable is part of the pie chart that says what you could eat. Some people remember that? Not hallucinating. I'm old.
It's bizarre, but when you think about it, I mean, again, food as a system, can connect us to our values again. Food as a system can have so much impact in the lives of poor folks. Food as a system can help improve racial relations. Food as a system can mitigate type 2 diabetes and heart disease. As a system, right? But I think the problem is, and this is a problem in policy, often people look at food sources of debate, is it GMO or not GMO? Is it organic or not? And it's not that those issues are not important, you know, they are. But if you think about it as a holistic system, you can end up doing, I think, so much more good. And I got so frustrated by it, I actually wrote an open letter in the New York Times to presidential candidates. And I asked them to pay attention to food. And I asked them, what would it look like if we started over in food? A few campaigns responded. Most campaigns that responded actually have already dropped out, so I don't know what that says about it. But one responded that's still in. But we've been working with Republicans, very conservative Republicans, and very liberal Democrats. And we've said to them, why not adopt a set of proposals under the what would look like we start over sort of banner? Whether it's crop insurance to encourage farmers to grow some carrots and kale instead of just soy and corn, right? What about entrepreneurship programs for poor kids in Detroit? So instead of going down the path that they might be going down, they could start real food companies that are making a difference in their community. What does that look like? And we're getting a little bit of traction. We just hired a VP of policy that used to be the deputy chief of staff at the USDA to help drive it. And it's been interesting working with some of these politicians because I think they're used to companies like ours going in and asking for something. And all we're asking for is they stand up and take some leadership in this big system of food. We're asking that they break out of the partisanship in food because it's a system that doesn't have to break down in that way. And they can do something.
It's interesting that you say that. Sometimes when my father always used to tell me a theory, when something completely breaks down and falls to rubble is the only time that you can remake something. And he was having this first conversation with me, I think over like a pile of Lego or Tinker Toys, right? I was crying because this castle I had made had fallen apart. And he said, well, now you can rebuild it and make it better, right? Yeah. And I remember 7 years ago going to Detroit and making our TV show. I got to send you this clip. We went to the weekend farmers market in Detroit, and because that city had become so hard hit, and because there were so many people that had lost jobs, and because the economy had dealt so many people there an unfair set of cards, their farmers market was the single most vibrant one nationally I had ever seen.
Wow.
Now, in summertime, everywhere you go that has, you know, arable, you know, land, soil that can, where you can grow things, they're going to have, depending on the weather system, tomatoes and carrots and pumpkins and all the rest of that, and good farmers are going to grow good vegetables. I'm not talking about those kind of booths. There were families that were just in the pie business. There were families making pickles. There was a lady making root beer. There was one woman who had finally gotten a national grocer to pick up her homemade sweet tea that she started making iced tea and bottling it herself. Now, the majority of these businesses were gray market, and a lot of them didn't want us to shoot them on the show because they thought I'm gonna get fined because we're kind of doing this in our house, right?
Right.
But they had so many loyal customers. Several of them said yes. So people who were making cheese and salami and, you know, you can make food, you know, you can make 20 sandwiches, and if they're really good, go out on the street somewhere and sell them all and pocket a few dollars and do it every day and then get a cart and then get a restaurant. And then the next thing you know, you got 200 units all around the country making these great sandwiches. Food is one of the few places where that can happen. In Detroit, I've seen it with my own eyes actually happen with food entrepreneurship. It's an incredible space because people can do it with an extremely small amount of square footage, like just their sink at their house.
Totally.
And a cutting board, right? So it's an amazing opportunity for impact. When you think about the politicians and the regulators and all of these launches in food service and retail and the size of your company and the incredible growth, that trip to Liberia that you just had, you started a school, right?
Well, we're doing something.
Announced it.
Well, we're doing something hopefully even more impactful than that, Andrew. We're, you know, Liberia, unfortunately, has just been ravaged by war,
yeah.
By Ebola recently. I mean, it's been through some hell,
yeah.
Right? And unfortunately, a lot of the little girls in Liberia have been the most victimized. They might have gone to school in first grade and then back again in eighth grade. Most of them, just to eat, have to sell their bodies. Right. Talk about the linkage between food and their life, right?
Just got back from West Africa 2 weeks ago.
Where'd you go?
We were in Senegal, but I've been in 38 some countries,
yeah.
There. I mean, I've seen the same thing you have.
So we're working with the Ministry of Education and some other leaders in Liberia to try to put together a better school feeding program. You know, if you don't have food in Liberia that's rich in micronutrients, it's difficult to think. If you don't have food in the school, often the girls won't even go to school, again, because they want to eat, right? And again, that's an example, I think, of, you know, what you talked about, the reason you do your show. It's more than just food, right? It can be a bridge to so much more. So we're trying to do a little bit of good there.
Well, once you see, I mean, as a traveler, your life becomes transformed. I sat there and watched families explain to me that the kids couldn't go to school because they had to work,
yeah.
To help put food, not because the parents wanted to collect the money to go on a, you know, carnival cruise, right? I mean, we're talking about tiny villages in little countries way off the grid, just because the family needed to bond together to plant crops that month.
Yeah.
And if the crops didn't get in the ground and then pray for rain, no one was eating 6 months.
Mm.
From there. I mean, that's what you're fighting against,
there,
right?
There's a fascinating thing in international development. There's a place called the MIT Poverty Lab, and it talks about the multiplier effect of educating a girl, right? Educating one girl and investing in a girl, you end up doing lots of other positive things. She's 45% less likely to be abused herself. Her kid is 25% more likely to get an education. She's 40% more likely to have a job. I mean, all these things, right? And if you dig deeper into the policy, though, one of the reasons why girls aren't being educated is because schools don't have food,
mm-hmm.
Right? And again, that's the power, I think, of looking at food as a system instead of this narrow thing. If you kind of step back and realize how it penetrates all these areas of life, you realize there's so much more you can do with it.
Yeah, I shot a wild animal, a big one, with a tribe that that's allowed to cull certain number of animals from the local hoofed animals around. It was a big wildebeest, and I was in Namibia, and we could only eat so much of it, so we took the rest of it to a school, and the kids started screaming with delight, and I was talking to the principal, because we were just dropping off meat. I mean, we can't use it. I believe you eat what you kill, but I had hundreds of pounds of meat that I couldn't use. And so we asked around. They said, oh, there's a school down there, they'll take the meat. So we took the meat to them, and to see 200 kids starting ripping it apart, not to eat it, but to prepare it, to salt it, and smoke it, because there's no electricity.
Wow.
So they didn't have refrigerators, but all these kids, I'm talking about 7, 8, 9, 10-year-olds, knew how to treat the meat and dry it so that they could essentially have meat to eat. And I asked the principal, when was the last time they had meat in the school? And she said, easily 3 or 4 months.
Wow.
Before that. I mean, that's what we're fighting against. And we wonder in our country why with 40% waste and 20% people who are, you know, food insecure, don't know where their next meal is coming from, why we have this out of balance food system globally, not just nationally.
Yeah.
When you start to compare country by country, we have to level the playing field.
Well, you know, there are 2.5 billion people that live in what folks call energy poverty. They don't have refrigeration.
Yeah.
And I think the best version, we're not here yet, the best version of Hampton Creek is a Hampton Creek that recognizes that we're not just trying to provide food for, you know, people in Birmingham, Alabama, and Austin, Texas, but we're trying to provide food for people that do not have refrigeration. And how does that inform how we think about it, right? And how do we work with farmers around the world, not just to produce food for people here, but also to produce for friends in West Africa too. That's the best version of us.
But that's that poverty lab idea that we always talk about. And it's not just MITs. I mean, you put farmers to work, they start to make a little money. They have some solar arrays. They begin to put electricity into their town. You can then keep antibiotics in a refrigerator in a field hospital. I mean, the multiplier effect of jobs through food, which is why I always believe, despite being a left-wing Lindsay liberal myself politically, that business is going to solve a lot of these problems.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, the business of creating business solves problems because it gives people opportunity. I believe business is opportunity. In a couple of minutes, we are going to invite people to ask questions. There's a microphone. There are lights in my bed, but I see a stick standing up about 20 feet deep in there. So if anybody would like to start lining up to ask a question, we're gonna make, because I like the sound of my own voice more than anyone's in the whole world. But more than that, I really wanna have a conversation with you people, and I know that Josh does too. So please line up and get ready to ask us some questions. We've sort of just started to make this a regular thing, you and I, talking here about these issues. I hope we do it for many more years to come. Your company has changed a lot in the last year, and it's changed a lot, you know, every year since we keep touching base with each other one way or another. What do you think the biggest change is going to happen over the next year or two, to the next time we're sitting, let's just say a year, to the next time we're sitting here on this stage talking about the world of food and the idea of starting over, if you could?
I think the biggest change will probably be today, about 99% of what we do is in the U.S. Right after this, I'm flying to Hong Kong, and we're doing some.
Are you and I having dinner in like Shanghai or something in 4 days?
I would love to, man. I don't think so, though.
Okay, you got to fly back. I'm doing Okinawa and Shanghai on Monday. I'll text you.
Please,
I'll text you.
Please. So we're. I think you're going to see much more international in how we do things. You know, today we do a little bit of business in Asia, but you know, I always believe that what we were doing, the starting over deal, is not just an American thing, and we're proud to be, you know, headquartered here in America. But you really have an impact when you realize that food is just as precious to someone who lives in Beijing as again Birmingham. So I think you're going to see much more international manufacturing facilities, international, more engagement with farmers across Sub-Saharan Africa, across Latin America. And more people that work for Hampton Creek that are not just based here in the U.S. but based around the world.
It's fantastic. My friend Josh Tetrick.
Wow. Thanks, man.
I applaud you. I you know, we're away from this kind of stuff. We've actually become friends IRL in real life. And when I realized the more we were talking about this and like what you want to talk about and questions I might ask and stuff like that, I realized, and I think it's really true, the greatest thing that you can pay to somebody, I think, in business, are you a maker? There are a lot of businesses that are either takers or they make money off creating nothing.
Yeah.
There's lots of examples. Everyone knows what I'm talking about. I applaud you for being a maker and continuing to be a maker. I think that's really important.
Thanks,
I think
Andrew.
Makers change the world.
We're pushing it. We're pushing it.
You are.
Well, I should tell you before questions, if you guys are thinking about starting a company, if you're an entrepreneur right now, and you're not really considering starting a company in the world of food, I think you're crazy. I really think you're crazy. Because the opportunity is to do so much good, whether in your local community or globally, through reorienting the system, are massive. And even if you don't care about doing good, frankly, you should still do it. Because the opportunities, not enough smart people who want to be makers are looking at the world of food. And the opportunities are just endless.
We're changing our food. My hospitality company, Passport Hospitality, decided this year we're starting a 5-year plan to change it entirely over, where all the people who work for us are people who are coming out of jails and institutions.
Wow.
Because if you don't give them a job,
so
well,
cool.
Just like I'm not in a position to create, you know, I'm a entrepreneur of a different type and I have different things, but I can remake my business by putting different kinds of people to work to increase opportunities for their families and their people. And why wouldn't I do it?
Yeah.
I think it creates loyalty. First question.
Are we at? Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. Get close to it.
Good afternoon. I really applaud what you guys are doing and what you're saying. You're great evangelists for the cause of healthy and affordable food. My name is Michael Buczurki. I'm a former spokesperson for UNICEF, so I've been to many of the countries you've been to.
Cool.
And one I particularly remember is Lesotho, you know, landlocked, small country, one of the poorest in the world, landlocked by South Africa. And there are a lot of projects there to, as you said, to educate girls and empower them. But what eventually happens sometimes is the girls are able to go to school, but then they don't have money for shoes or they don't have money for books, and that really holds them back. Anyway, my question is, I'm doing a TEDx talk in Europe in a couple of weeks, and one of the things I wanted to address is the migrant crisis. And it seems to me a lot of people are having to leave places in Africa because of scarcer resources, and a lot of it brought about by climate change, less arable land, less available land to grow food. Do you guys have any thoughts on that? Does that keep you awake at night, how climate change is going to make it really, really tough to grow food in some of those poor places in the world?
Yeah, you know, it's food as a system again. I lived in Kenya and spent some time with farmers in northern Kenya, where I know you've certainly been before, Andrew, and climate change is impacting those farmers in a significant way. It's making it more and more difficult for them to grow what they need to ultimately export it, and then it goes back to them not having enough money to send their little girls to school.
Yeah.
So it's a significant deal, right? And I think, you know, the international climate change policy experts and what we saw recently in Paris, I think they did a slightly better job of looking at the implications of food, but not nearly good enough, mm-hmm. right? So I think, you know, policymakers all across the place need to realize the integration of food in all this. But I also think there are a lot of crops out there that might use a little bit less water and less land, that are a little bit more resistant to some of the consequences of climate change. Sorghum has to be one of them. Yellow pea is actually another one that we might see some farmers around the world switch to. And now, that doesn't provide all the answers. But I do think as we create more and more market opportunities for some of these crops, hopefully it can help a little bit. But it's a serious problem, and it's good to have someone like you even asking the question.
It does keep me up at night, too. And I can tell you, as I travel around, the story that I hear everywhere, I call them dying breeds. It's my little nickname in my head to remember them. But the most recent one, just in Senegal, the Salt Lake, Lac Rose, it's a pink lake, and it is the source of income for thousands of people in a very, very poor African country. But climate change is changing the tides. It's changing the amount of silt that comes in, and it has caused, they're seeing every year they're able to harvest less and less salt, not because the salt itself isn't there at the bottom of the lake, but because climate change is creating a problem in the environment and in allowing them to access it. They actually go out there, they smear their bodies with oil and shea butter so the salt doesn't adversely affect them, and they collect it by standing on homemade wire stilts and sifting it in the water. I mean, and get paid pennies on the pound for it, and their opportunity is disappearing. I think climate is a huge changer in this, and why actually I think all good policy needs to be global and needs to be holistic. I mean, I think we used to have the luxury of being able to solve a problem over here and wrap it with a bow and put it up in the attic and say, okay, problem solved. I think we're in an interdependent place in our global history that most people don't see because they don't have the opportunity to step back and see the planet for what it really is. So bravo. I look forward to hearing that TED talk.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Michael.
Next question.
Hello, my name is Enrique.
Hello, Enrique.
I am from Mexico. And like you, Josh, I grew up with shitty food. There's a lot of diabetes in my family, as in Mexico also. And I almost was diabetic. I have a food company. So we want to take out of the equation of processed foods, fats, eggs, sugars. So we create specialty ingredients out of fruit processing waste streams. So we work with tropical fruit seeds and peels. And the case of Mexico is really interesting. And something that keeps me up at night is we're creating technology and ingredients for companies to innovate. And we're also tying the gastronomy side to it. But how can you democratize nutrition where when you have a country and the distribution channels to reach millions of people, they belong to three companies. So how can you beat that?
So who do you sell to? You sell to manufacturers, or you would sell to the end consumer?
Manufacturers.
You sell to manufacturers. Got it. And how old's your company?
2 years.
3 years, okay. So a few things, they might not completely address your question, but I'll try to. So one is, most people in food that kind of run bigger food companies that I asked advice to when I started ended up being completely wrong about everything. They told me we couldn't, you know, do our own brand. They told me distribution channels were too difficult. They told me it'd take us 20 years to do what we're doing right now. And the advice was almost completely bullshit. So just realize if you're asking a lot of people for advice, especially like traditional food folks, some of them got it, but most have no idea what the hell they're talking about. So just keep that in mind. The second thing I would say to you is, you know, begin to consider what would it look like to actually reach the end consumer, right? You said you make an ingredient, you said?
Yeah, we make a set of ingredients.
Gotcha, okay. So one, and this is just for you to consider, right? So what does it look like instead of making an ingredient if you actually make the whole product, whatever that product is? Because you told me your distribution channels are limited because they're controlled by three, right?
Yeah.
Well, if you end up making a whole product, suddenly your distribution channels are not so limited, right? They're much, much broader. Mm-hmm. And that when Hampton Creek started, this is even before we met Andrew, I thought we were gonna be an ingredient company. That's what I thought.
Yeah.
In part because I know what the hell I was doing. And it ended up really enabling us to go much faster because instead of relying on the biggest food companies, I could just rely on myself and my team. And if we can package it, if we can convince consumers to be a part of it, well, then we get the distribution we need. So I'd ask you to at least consider that. And then finally, if you decide to continue being an ingredient, I think, you know, maybe not just focus on the big three, focus on some smaller ones to get started, to try to get in it. You really get the traction you need to really build up the story for the bigger three. But you're always welcome to just email me directly. I'm just at josh@hamptoncreek.com. It sounds like you're doing a really awesome thing, Enrique, and anything we can do to help, we'd love to.
Yeah, thank you. Like, if you have 5 minutes after the talk, it would be awesome.
Sure.
When it comes to, you used a very interesting word, democratize nutrition.
Yep.
The first thing I thought of was pivoting your company, because selling to those other companies isn't going to democratize anything.
Yep.
And you smiled when you said it. So I really think democratizing nutrition is in your heart, and go there. Follow that, I think, wherever that leads. And democratizing anything is also about education. Right. And having, you know, I spend a couple weeks in Mexico every year working. You know, look at the education problem around the world in every country. You know, we all have to educate other people about these issues so that they can make more intelligent and healthy choices for themselves. Who's next?
Thank you,
Enrique.
Thanks, Enrique.
Go Mexico.
So my name is Ashley Zanoli, and I work for the US EPA. And I'm really happy that you're both looking at ways to drive federal legislation. But
can you just speak a little closer,
sure,
to the microphone? There you go. Perfect.
I'm recovering from pneumonia, too, so sorry. I'm soft-spoken.
No problem.
So in the meantime of the pathway to federal legislation, there's a lot of work that the federal and local governments are doing to reduce wasted food. Andrew, you mentioned that about 40% of food's ultimately going uneaten. So Josh, how is your company helping to bridge the gaps and not only talk about how to make healthy food more available to low-income families, but to utilize the vast amount of wasted nutrients? About 10 million pounds of uneaten fruit and vegetables are going to waste on our farms,
yeah,
and 40% of that big 40% of what's being wasted is a lot of wholesome fruit and vegetables. So it's part of the conversation I really haven't heard people like you talk about.
Yeah, no, and it's a really important one. One thing we're doing around it is there's a big food service company called Compass Group. They serve about 4 billion meals a year, and they're one of our most important partners. We have a five-year global partnership with them. And they recently launched a program where they work with farmers to ask them, why the heck are you throwing away a vegetable that might have an ugly-looking bump on it, right? Or a peach that has a little bit of bruise, right? These ugly fruit and vegetables that, you know, farmers just end up throwing away because people don't want to buy them. And it's insane when you think about it. The peach tastes good and the carrot tastes good. So we've been working with Compass Group on some media stuff, on some storytelling things to try to make that happen a little bit more effectively. And beyond that, as a company, openly, we haven't done a lot about it. And I think it's something as we continue to get on and live our values, it's got to be something we pay attention a lot more to. We've thought about actually developing where we work with a lot of restaurants, and we want to get more data from restaurants about how often they're using a lot of our food products. So instead of just overbuying it, right, and they end up throwing it away, like when the shelf life runs out, getting sort of a rhythm on how often they're using it and just shipping it to them directly when they actually need it, as opposed to them just buying too much. So it's kind of an example of using elements of data science in the process of food production, but we're not there yet. But it's something that's really important, and I'm glad someone like you is paying attention to it.
There are finally, and it's a crucial question, there are finally companies in the United States, Loving Spoonfuls being one that I work with out of Massachusetts, that does food rescue, but has figured out a scalable and transferable system for food rescue that other people can pick up in their parts of the world. When I was in San Francisco, and I would encourage you to come to Babson to Food Days, where Project Soul and the Lewis Institute supports this incredible conversation for 2 days about these issues with young people that I think you'd really, really dig. But one of the things that has come out of a lot of the food waste research and going out and telling stories about people who are trying to solve this problem, I was most impressed with a very radical anarchistic group that gets a lot of negative press called Food Not Bombs. And because they steal wasted food and they feed it illegally to people who need it out of unlicensed, it's just like, wow. There's hungry people, the food's in the garbage can, we don't care if someone else owns the garbage can, we're taking the food, we're cleaning it, we're gonna cook.
That's badass.
It's pretty impressive. And a lot of these young people get arrested doing it, and you know, with me and my cameras, the cops were there and were like, go ahead. I mean, I was hoping to get arrested because I thought it would make a lot of noise. You know, Andrew Zimmern arrested feeding homeless people in San Francisco. I mean, I was just like, let's get it on, let's talk about that. And one of the things that came out of it was making soup. Whenever I, in my house, see all those carrots that are no longer crisp, you hold one end and you can wiggle it and it looks more like a piece of licorice. We put everything together and we make a vegetable soup. I mean, just you can puree it, you can dice it, saute it. There's 1,000 ways to deal with it, which is why I love that you work with chefs. Because the solution any chef will tell you is I waste nothing in my house because at a certain point I process it.
Yeah.
Right, into something else that then becomes good on itself, and it's easy to freeze soup and it's delicious. So there are a lot of companies out there now that are starting to do this. I'm on the board of Sxsw, Services for the Underserved in New York. We have thousands of people so far below the poverty line who are, we give them housing, we give them medical attention, job training, all the rest of this. And we actually bought some soup franchises and have put people to work processing donated food that would otherwise wind up in the garbage because the supermarket doesn't want to sell that peach that came in nice but got bruised sitting there. No one's going to buy it. So that's why they throw it in the garbage. So if we can collect it and turn it to soup and sell it, I think there's some wisdom in there. And every time I bring up this idea with people, they say that would never scale, that could never be global, it could never happen. I'm like, you know something? You go to the largest open air market in Africa, the one in Addis Ababa in Ethiopia, and you look at the mounds of food just rotting in a country that can grow anything but has a lot of problems with feeding people. That distribution point, that space between the food coming out of the ground and actually getting it to the people has so many different opportunities for solutions. You talk about entrepreneurs out there. Yeah. You work in that space.
No doubt.
Holy moly, what a cool thing. So hopefully some answers soon.
And think about, guys, the questions that have been asked. I heard a question about like climate change and farmers in the developing world. We heard a question about nutrition, equitable nutrition for folks in Mexico. We just heard a question about food waste. We talked about distribution. There are 5 companies right there you should start.
Yeah.
Right? That's the point of thinking about food as a system, right? There are all these different verticals of food, all of them pretty fucked up, right? And you can say, what would it look like if we started over to each and every single one of them, and you can create a company. You can make money starting a company and employ people creating a company and do good through the power of business.
And there's a pathway to that. There's about 20 impact investors who just launched a website called ReFed, and we came out with a report on Wednesday.
Awesome.
So you can apply for grants, and there's some large coattails we can all ride. The Ad Council is launching a $3 million campaign that'll launch May 3rd on preventing wasted food. So something your company might want to take advantage
of. And it's called ReFed, R-E-F-E-D?
Yeah, it stands for Rethinking Food Waste Through Economics and Data. So
love
that.
Check
it out. And thanks for your answers.
Thank you. That's awesome.
Thanks for doing that.
Speaking of advertising, My name's Amanda, and that's the field I work in. We talked a lot about how the candidates today are not talking about food. It's not necessarily at the government level, but in my field, I kind of feel we vote with our wallet, no matter how thin it might be, every day, much more often than most Americans vote, unfortunately, during the course of their lives. So I wondered if you had any call to actions for us on how we could use our wallets and our taste buds to make small votes that would change this food system that we've been talking about.
A few things. I mean, if you've got to think about as individuals what your values are, right? Like what you actually believe in, what you care about. And I found, again, whether you're Republican or a Democrat, like most people, all things being equal, believe that we should probably feed our kids food that didn't have so much crap in it, right? Most people, Republican or Democrat, believe, well, maybe if the food is using less resources, right? Whether you believe in climate change or not, maybe it's a little bit better. Maybe if you're getting food that's more supportive of farmers instead of degrading farmers, it's a better thing, right? And, you know, there are a few companies out there that are doing a little bit of good, and I don't need to mention, you guys are probably familiar with a lot of them. So I think if you do have the means, I think supporting them is better than supporting some others. And I think, you know, every once and again, you know, send a note, even if it's to a mega company that seems like they're trying to do good, send a note to them saying you appreciate what they're doing too. Because often that note gets forwarded to someone that has a lot of power within the company, then ends up having quite of an impact too. But it's, there unfortunately are not enough food choices right now that I think connect with people who don't live in a world where they're making over $100,000, you know? There are not enough of that. And when you see food companies that are attempting to do that, I think really shine a spotlight on them and try to support them.
Agree. I would come around it from the other side as well. The best way to vote with your feet in your wallet is to make an investment in yourself and learn how to cook.
Yeah.
And cook more, and cook more often. And here's the magic of it. I tell people all the time, cook. And half the stuff you make each week, try cooking something new each time. Number one, it's the only way to learn. Number two, it immerses yourself in books and magazines and websites and other places where you'll get turned on to a symphony of ideas. But by learning to cook more things and a greater variety of them, by the end of a year, you are no longer putting money into the hands of processors and people who are making a lot of food that isn't necessarily that great for you, but you're cooking more from scratch, supporting growers and makers in your own economy. It's why spending money to join a co-op is so important. I mean, it killed me. I am the poster child for, you know, old fat white guys that just want things to be okay for them. You know, I have to work really hard to think outside of what's me and think about everyone else. Like, I work at it really hard. My wife actually is the one that changed our shopping habits and to go to certain stores, and I was like, that is the simplest idea of all time. Huh. Why should I be putting my money and a percentage of it into the hands of people that aren't doing good works?
Totally.
Better the local co-op and that $85 check, whatever it is I write each year to keep my membership alive, is the best money that I ever spend. But I really do think cooking,
no doubt,
is the secret sauce.
So Andrew, I mentioned we wrote that letter to presidential candidates in the New York Times. We wrote a letter to 23-year-olds asking them to start companies that compete directly with us. And we also wrote a letter to great-grandmas. And we asked great-grandmas what would it look like if we started over in food. And I put my cell phone number at the end of the letter too, and on a Sunday I got like 73 calls from great-grandmas around the country. which was pretty awesome. I saved a lot of the voicemails. But what was amazing about their answer is, you know, we do all this computational biology and fancy stuff in Hampton Creek. They didn't say any of that. They said, how about starting over be about just teaching people how to cook? Like, beautiful, simple wisdom. Doesn't require, you know, all this stuff. And I think it connects with exactly where you're coming from.
You learn how to transform stuff. We were talking about plants earlier, and yeah. I mentioned sweet potato. I mean, it's a thing. Everyone looks at the sweet potato, but in Japan, they eat the sweet potato and figured out things to do with it, like put it in tempura and stuff. But what they really know how to do is to deal with the vines, which they pickle 1,000 different ways and cook 100 different ways, because they have a squishy, gooey texture that they just, it's highly prized over there. And you do a ton of stuff with the leaves. There are plants like that where we're just using a small fraction of it. And by cooking and educating yourselves, you turn yourself onto a wealth of new ideas on this subject. Anyway.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Sir, you were the last question.
All right, great.
No pressure, though.
I guess first thing I'll say, I love the cookie dough. It's a brilliant product.
Oh, thanks, man.
It's also pretty hard to get right now, so I was curious what, you know, you have to hunt it down in a super target. So what have been some of the challenges in scaling to where you are now, and then, you know, from now going forwards with 43 products? Is it production? Is it the distributors? And how are you working on that?
No, it's a good question. Target actually just told us they're going to be rolling out to all of them, so it'll be coming. But I think, you know, a big lesson for me, remember, this is the first real company I've ever started, so I'm learning all this on the fly still. One of the things I didn't realize is you can have the best, you know, culinarians in the world, but if you don't have, you know, an operational infrastructure to bring their creativity to the world, it doesn't matter. So we've since really built up a manufacturing footprint of about 9 manufacturing facilities here in the country, and one in Canada that are now operating almost 24/7, each of them, making sure that we're able to make enough and deliver things on time and the way they need to. We were so fortunate enough to be able to grow so fast, and we were in Whole Foods, and before you know it, we're in Safeway, Walmart, Target, everywhere. That our sales, 2 years ago, were actually ahead of our operations. So we've since really built up an incredible operations team led by a guy that actually built the DVD distribution business at Netflix. And it's really enabling us to scale in a way that enables us to accomplish what we're trying to.
Thank you.
Thank you, man. Very much.
One more. Aww. I know, I was hiding.
I was wrong, you were right. You're the last question.
I'm the last question. Josh, I just want to thank you for everything that you've done. I'm a huge fan of your products and your company, but I did have one question that segues into the advertising question a little bit.
Yeah.
Obviously, processed food is a huge topic today in the food world, and there's a lot of conversation around getting people back to the roots, and Andrew, you mentioned getting back to cooking. And I'm a huge fan of your products, but it begs the question, at the end of the day, Hampton Creek is producing processed food. And can you maybe speak to how you're educating consumers, or maybe, because I haven't seen much of it, but how you're educating consumers on what products and ingredients are in their food so that they have a better understanding of how things are going from the field to the fork?
Yeah, it's a really important one. I think, you know, the answer to what would it look like if we start over in food certainly isn't just, and the approach that we're, you know, attempting to take the lead on is one way, right? Mm-hmm. But another way is, to Andrew's point, and I think what you're getting at is, let's teach people how to cook. Whether you're in Detroit or in San Francisco, let's teach people how to cook. I think our responsibility in that, I think, is twofold. One, it's actually sharing that message more, right? And we've done a little bit of it, not nearly enough of it. And then the second is, we've since tried to get deeper and deeper with the farmers that we work with in the Midwest and Canada and elsewhere. And I think it's our responsibility to share their stories more, right? Not just to share the story of a delicious cookie dough or delicious mayo, but share the story of a farmer who's a part of that, and bring that content to people through multiple channels and really shine a bright spotlight on that. And I think that's something we need to do a lot more of.
I happen to think processed food has been, the definition has been hijacked. Mm-hmm. I'm glad you asked this question, because I find myself getting really angry and upset about the issues around how we define terms in the food world. It is 2016, it is not 1716, okay? People are time poor. There are folks out there that wish they could cook every single day and simply can't. They're lucky enough to do what, you know, what I do, which is I cook once a week at my house on Sunday nights, and I make 3-4 things and a soup and salad dress, whatever, and I put it in the fridge, and that's like that's the best I can do. And my son and my wife, other people pick up some of the pieces and stuff like that, but I'm away a lot. We rely on a lot of restaurants and a lot of packaged ingredients. I'll just call them packaged ingredients, stuff that isn't necessarily on the outer aisle of the supermarket, for what we eat. And I think almost every single person in here to a certain degree does. And when we have these conversations, we forget that it's changing the nature of what's in the middle of that supermarket that is what's so important. I mean, look, it's great to make cookies from scratch, but you want to know something? Thankfully, there are some good products out there now. Josh is being our family's. My kid eats the cookie dough raw. He can't. There are people in his company that literally are sending. I think they're going under financially because of my son eating too much cookie dough. He's also like 700 pounds. No, he's just skinny. He's a skinny kid. But the amazing thing is that there are now choices out there. The word processed food has gotten such a bad rap because some of the processed food that we've become addicted to over the last 30 or 40 years is so medically harmful to us, you know, societally destructive, unsustainable to either eat or to manufacture. I'm all for processing food. If someone can figure out a way to take all of that wasted fruit and vegetable and turn it into pies and desserts and things in the freezer section or, you know, whatever, that is fantastic. I think what we have to do is get back to the idea of defining what food is and working it forward from there. So, great question.
Yeah, thank you both.
Great place to end. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, my
well
man.
Done.
Always.